And immediately,
the Lord said, yes, right here. Well, I leave the service, my friend goes, hell, not that one, right? Like, she was for sure we weren't going to stay there, because that's not what we had decided we were going to do. See, we were ready to go right. But I heard the Lord, and the Lord said, yes, right here, stay here. I had a choice in that moment, go left or go right. I chose left because I heard God. It wasn't comfortable. It might not have been the exact thing I was looking for, but God knew that it was a purpose on my way to my destiny.
Vive Dios.
When I became a youth leader, one of the things the Lord put on my heart almost instantaneously was this, was to make sure you go after the people that are unloved. Maybe the ones that other people will skim over. There was a reason for that, because you know that most people won't come to churches because they feel condemnation. The main reason why somebody doesn't step into church is because of condemnation. They feel that if they walk in, God bless you guys, that if they walk in, people are going to see the sin all over them and they're going to judge them. And I'm sorry, as Christians, we've done a bad job of that, because we do judge them, even if we don't say it to their face. It's the look out of the corner of our eye. It's the little smirk. It's the little stay away. It's the I can't hug you or embrace you. It's the talking under your tongue, but yet they still see. See, with eyes of Jesus, Jesus doesn't see that person that way when they walk through the door. What Jesus sees is what he created them to be. And he says, this is my child. I have a destiny and I have a purpose. I have something inside of them that I want you to pull out of them. Don't look at them with condemnation. See, we have the Holy Spirit that brings conviction. But it says in Romans, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
There is no conviction. And it is not even your job to convict them. It is your job to bring the Holy Word of God to come in and to renew them, to restore them to the place that God has called them to be.
Yes.
So when somebody walks in there, you best believe you better get up off your seat and hug them and embrace them and tell them what you see when you look at them. See them with the eyes of Jesus. See, and Jonah couldn't do that. Jonah saw disgusting people, gross people. So he chose not to do what God called him to do, because he judged the people that he was supposed to go deliver the word to.
Yes.
See, and this is what happens. Guys, when we decide to look at somebody with Jesus' eyes, oh my goodness, guys, all of a sudden you release these people into their destiny. All of a sudden, it's a lie of the enemy what they see. That's not what God sees. He doesn't see that. So when you release into somebody's life what you see, how Jesus sees them, you are now actually releasing them into their destiny. You are changing the course of their life, and you're changing your heart. It's so cool. It's one of those things that you get to give and receive all at the same time. Amen?
Hallelujah.
Fear was another thing. I believe truly he was thinking one of two things. Now, I didn't say this in the Word of God, sometimes you're just assuming things by reading the text, but also, him walking into that place, he doesn't know what's going to happen to him when he goes there. It's not his place. It's not his people. And he's coming to bring a message of doom. So when he walks in, he could have very well been fearful of his life. At the very least, fearful that they weren't going to receive the word. How many times have you not gone right when God said go right? Out of fear. How many times did you stay right here out of fear? Fear that they're not going to understand. Fear that I'm not good enough. Fear will stop you. It is crippling. Fear will stop you from your purpose on the way to your destiny. Because the enemy will put one little seated lie inside of you to tell you who you are, and you will never walk forward anymore. Even if the GPS keeps saying, go, 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 go. Even if it's yelling at you, you're standing still, you need to go, you need to go. You're so frightened in fear, you don't move. And this happens. Sometimes Christians get stuck in this for years. But there is a scripture, and it's in 2 Timothy. I think it's 1:7, and it says, the Lord has not given you a spirit of fear, but a power. Come
yes.
on, somebody. Of love and of sound
Amen.
Mind. Do you understand? When God says go right, I don't care how impossible it is, he will give you the power to do so, the love to do so, and a sound mind to walk it out.
Yes.
And I'll tell you, I shouldn't be here probably being a preacher if it's from the world standards. But God said, do not have a spirit of fear, Renee. Get up, because you have the power, you have the love, and you have a sound mind. Doesn't mean the enemy doesn't try to bring the spirit of fear. But that's where you're saying, no, that's not what my God said. So don't ever let fear stand in your way of the direction that God is bringing you. Amen?
Amen.
So, Jonah decides to go the opposite direction. Anybody familiar with that? Have you ever gone the opposite direction of where God told you to go? Or have you ever just shut off the GPS altogether? And just said, I don't need God. I can do it on my own. Mm-hmm. My directions are better. My beliefs are better. Mm-hmm. Well, this is where Jonah was at. He gets out of the boat. Now, what's crazy, which if any of you have ever been one that either shut the GPS off or went right instead of left, you know that God comes after you. God doesn't just say, oh, well, sayonara, see you later. That's okay with me. God is following right behind you. Like, no matter where you go, you can try to run as far as you want to run away from God. He's always right there. Well, with Jonah, he comes in the form of bringing a storm. You want to get on that boat? Okay, great. Let me show you who I am. I'm the God of gods. I am the God of the sea, too. So you can get on the sea to try to escape me, but the sea's still mine, too, so you really can't get away from me. So he gets on the boat, and the boat, all of a sudden, the waves start coming, they start crashing, and all of a sudden, the boat starts to come apart. Is that what your life looks like when you go right instead of left? The roller coaster of emotions of the ocean, up and down? Do you feel unstable on the boat where it's like rocking and your life is just rocking? You know something's not right. There's really no joy. There's really no peace. Maybe a little bit of momentary peace when you're doing something of the world, but nothing. You're on that boat and you're rocking back and forth. Do pieces of your life feel like they're being pulled off of you, taken away from you when you're going the wrong direction? Well, this is what was happening with Jonah when he was on the boat. So this is what Jonah decided to do. I'm going to go to sleep. Many people do that. They know they went the wrong direction. They know God's chasing after them, but what do? Ignore it. Well, time to go sleep. If I'm sleeping, I can't hear you. Mm-hmm. If I'm sleeping, huh? And that's like that song. People walking around with the fingers in their ears singing, la 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 la. I don't want to hear a sound. Why? Because they know. Once you have the Spirit of God in you, you know when the Spirit of God is chasing you. See, you know. So you're making a choice for them. But you know that voice of God is really big in your face. He knew what that storm was. Jonah full well knew what was happening. That's why he was late. Let me go to sleep. Maybe when you just block this out and I'll make it to the other side. Oh, no, you're not making it to the other side, buddy. So the people come, the captain, and they wake up Jonah. They're like, you know, Jonah, wake up. We're all praying to our gods. Maybe if you pray to your God, we'll get some sort of answer. So Jonah wakes up. He goes like, man, listen, my God is the God. Like the God of the creator, like the God of the sea is causing this. All of a sudden, fear comes over them because they realize he's the cause of what's happening. So actually what ends up happening is Jonah goes, man, forget it. I mean, at this point, it's over. Caught. These people know. God's coming at me, this and that. Just throw me overboard. It's the only way you guys can be saved. Just toss me off overboard. Do you know that the people didn't toss him off? The people in this world don't want him. They want to keep you. They want to keep you for as long as they can when you get away from God. Mm-hmm. Come on, just come to that party. Come on, you don't need to go to church today.
Hallelujah.
Oh, you do that God thing all the time. It's just the little things. It's just the little things. Because the world will try. They see that you've pulled away from God. They will try really hard. It's not even them. It's just the enemy using them as a tool. But we'll use them to keep them there. But let me tell you something. That storm kept coming so much. And they began to understand that the God inside of Jonah was way too big. And they decided even then they were going to throw him overboard. And so will the world when they realize that God's in you. And you have a calling and a purpose. And you're messing with them. That they're just going to throw.
Amen.
So a lot of times the very people that you were using to get you to the other side, to get you away from God, to hide away and sleep with the same ones that don't worry, I got your back, we're still going to try to go to the other side. The minute they realize how big God is, they toss you right off the side. Don't think about you again when you go the wrong direction.
Gloria a Dios.
But I have great news for you. When he got thrown off the side of that boat, when the people of the world threw him off the same way as happened to you before. Listen, I'm not even talking about when you completely walk away from God. I'm even just talking about when you make decisions that God's saying go right and he's telling you to go left. You'll always have somebody, even Christian people, they'll root you on to go the wrong direction. You might not even realize they're doing it. But I'm not even just talking about when you completely walk away from God. This sermon is not just about that. This sermon is also just about taking the wrong turn on the way to your destiny.
Hallelujah.
You can apply this to any of that. So here's what happens. They throw him overboard. But listen to this. God provides. provided a fish. Now, many of you know the story. They talk about the big whale and it swallows up Jonah. Anybody raise your hand if you ever heard of that? Okay. We don't even know if it's a whale. It just says big fish in the Word of God, just so you know. But listen, many of you think when you hear that, or maybe kids, they always think, like, God sent a fish and he swallowed up Jonah, and it seems scary. But do you realize that God provided the fish? So a lot of times, when you get to the end of yourself, when you start to finally realize that going the wrong direction, that going right was the wrong way, when God told you to go left, all of a sudden, when you get to the end of yourself, and when the world throws you out, and you're at the end of the end of the end, God will bring you something. He will provide something for you to pull you back out. And in this instance, he provided a fish in the middle of the sea. Now, does the fish seem comfortable or the best of things? No, but it was what God provided. God will give you a word. God will send somebody around you. God will give you a worship song. I know when I gave my life back to the Lord, it was as simple as a worship song. Praise you in the storm that my mom sent me a year ago. I popped it in the old VHS tape. You guys know what that is? Is that VHS? No, what's the tape?
No, that's a cassette.
Cassette tape. Yeah. See, so we'll let you know what it is. Put it in, and I just dropped to my knees, and I fully gave my life in that moment back to Christ. That was the belly of the fish for me. I didn't need anything big or elaborate. I just knew that God loved me. I knew I'm going to praise him in the middle of the storm. But how confidential is that, actually, that we're talking about that?
Hallelujah.
So here we are. You get small. God provides the fish. God provides whatever it is that you need in that moment.
Amen.
Now, mind you, I'm not just talking about when you walk away from God. I'm talking about when you go the wrong direction. There's a moment when you realize, ooh, I went the wrong way. What am I going to do now? Now you have 3 days and 3 nights to sit in the belly of a fish. And I want to talk about the 3 days and the 3 nights in the belly of a fish. I don't know about you, but I have quite a few moments in the belly of a fish. Yes. Raise your hand if you've ever had a 3 day, 3 night moment in the belly of a fish. Come on, amen. I'm going to read to you. I'm going to read to you right now what it says in Jonah 2, 1 through 8. From inside the fish, Jonah prayed to the Lord his God. He said, in my distress, I called to the Lord. Listen, and he answered me. The enemy wants you to think when you go the wrong direction or when you walk away from God that God's not going to answer you. Do you know how ready and available and willing and wanting and desiring he is to answer you? Immediately when Jonah began to pray, it says he answered me.
Yes.
From the deep in the realm of the dead, I called for help. See, he was able to notice, I just put myself back into a place of the dead. No longer am I walking with that life inside of me. He was able to recognize the place that he was in. And he said, from deep in the realm of the dead, I called for help. You listened to my cry. That gives me such assurance when I hear that. Because you know how many times I cry out to God and you always question, I wonder if he hears me. Yes, it says right here. And he listened to my cry. You hurled me into the depths, into the very heart of the seas, and the current swirled around me. All your waves and breakers swept over me. I said, I have been banished from your sight, yet I will look again towards your holy temple. The engulfing waters, they threatened me. The deep surrounded me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. To the roots of the mountain I sank down. The earth beneath me barred me in forever. But you, come on. But you, my Lord. See, because nothing is too big for God. But you, my Lord, brought my life out from the pit.
Yes.
When my life was ebbing away, I remembered you, Lord, and my prayer rose to you in your holy temple. Those who cling to the worthless idols turn away from God's love for them. But I, with shouts of grateful praise, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will make good. I will say, salvation comes from the Lord. When you recognize that you've been in the belly of the fish, you understand the goodness of God. Because to you, you realize it was death for the fish. And God brought it. And in those moments is when you start to self-reflect. It's those moments where you say, okay, I realize it. I went right instead of left. Okay, I realize it. I shut my GPS off altogether. I stopped listening to you, God. But now, listen, this is what he said. I vow to go back and do what I said I was called to do. Do you know the minute that Jonah said that and told the Lord that? I'm going to just finish up that scripture. This is verse 10. And the Lord commanded the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto dry land. All it took was saying, I recognize what I've done, and you are my Lord. And God put him right back on dry land. And he'll put you back on dry land. And he'll put you back, even if you went right. It's almost like a reset. He just picks you back up, puts you right back to where you were, and gets you started again. And so many of us walk around with the baggage of going right, the tree limbs and everything that was on the way there. But he doesn't take any of that back. Once you go back, you just go back. That's forgotten.
Mm-hmm.
Once you ask for forgiveness, it's over. It's covered by the blood of Jesus. And a lot of times you think your purpose and your destiny is over now because you went right instead of left, or because you walked away from God. But that's not the truth. Because right after that, Jonah went back to the Lord, and the Lord started all over again. Now, Jonah, I want you to go ahead and go to Nineveh, and I want you to go say this word to the Ninevites. Now, this is the exact thing he said at the beginning of Jonah. The very place God started with Jonah is the same place he started again with Jonah the minute he got vomited out of the fish's mouth and was back on dry land. See, your destiny and your purpose does not change. Your destiny and your purpose does not go away.
That's right.
You follow God. So when the enemy comes and says, well, you did that, so now you need 6 months of discipline. Sit down in that chair over there. Don't even come to church right now. So you get yourself all up together because you can't be used by God, because now your destiny and your purpose has changed, and you were going to be a pastor, but now you're just going to be someone that scrubs the toilet. Oh, no, my God says that my purpose and my destiny is in it. It was the same for Jonah then. It's the same for Jonah now.
Praise you, Lord.
See, because the enemy has told us, and even in churches have blinded our minds to understand that we are not to stand in the way of someone's purpose and destiny. We're there to help them along. And you know what's even more awesome? Is that whole time he feared about what was going to happen when he went to Nineveh. Do you realize when he went there? It was total opposite of whatever he even thought was going to happen. He went there, and what happened? The people immediately heard what was going to happen. Back in the Old Testament, that's what they do. They would tear their clothes off, they'd put sackcloth on, and then they would fast. That was a way of like being, reverence to God and going before the Lord. So they all did it. Even the king did it. Told everybody. He commanded them, do not even eat anything. We need to cry out to God and repent of our sins. So here was somebody that was scared. How can we not done something because of fear? But the minute you walk out in it, you realize, and that's what happened. He went and did what God told him to do. These people repented. They repented, and God, listen to this, he removed it. He took his mercy over them and decided not to kill them. So here was his whole destiny, was to make sure that these people weren't killed, the same people he thought were gross and disgusting and detestable.
Yes, there you go.
I said it earlier.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
But he used them. God used him, and God wants to use you. I'm sorry, he may have not been calling you to a 3,000-member church of everybody that knows the Lord and is holy and relevant. If he does, praise God, let you be used for that. But he may call you to be used in the street. He may call you to be used in your job. He may call you to be used in your school. You don't know, but when you begin to walk down the purpose of God, you will feel the peace of God over you when you are going the right direction.
Yes.
Can everybody stand up for me, please?
Gloria a Dios, aleluya, santo. Gracias,
Señor. I'm going to pray over you guys.